Hello everyone and welcome to theCUBE's live coverage of SaaS Innovate 2025 here in Orlando, Florida. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, and I have with me not one but two CUBE analysts. We have Paul Gillin, who is my colleague from many years back. We go way back, Paul.
We do. I can't remember how long it's been.
But it's a pleasure to be working with you again.
Always.
And my first time working with Scott Hebner. He is joined theCUBE in September. So your first ever show. So
this is the first show, first live show, yeah.
It's going to be a ball.
It's going to be a ball. Fun.
So all three of us are fresh from the main stage where we heard Brian Harris, CTO, as well as a number of SaaS executives talk about SaaS's vision, the portfolio. We heard about how models and via Copilot, other products are empowering people to be more productive, to make their lives easier. We heard agentic AI, digital twins, quantum AI. I want to hear first your thoughts, your impressions. Are you buying what they're selling? Paul, I want to start with you.
SaaS is always a fascinating company to me. I mean, I've been covering this company since the 80s. It will celebrate its 50th anniversary next year. How many software companies can say they've been around for 50 years and are not just around, but are actually growing and thriving, and you can see from the size of the crowd here, have an enthusiastic customer base. I thought it was interesting, the keynote this morning, the focus on AI. This is, of course, a company that has had grounding in analytics, but has really pivoted to a futuristic vision of AI. They're beyond generative, they're focusing on stuff like quantum AI that I wasn't even familiar with until this morning. They have a knack for looking out, looking around corners, looking over the edge, and continuing to be relevant in a market that moves at light speed.
Breakneck speed. Scott, how about you?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Paul. I mean, they start off with a really good position here, right? They are a establishment in the world of data, and you see the signs around here that are saying your AI future runs through your data. And I thought they did a really nice job in bringing that all to life today. And if there was one phrase that I thought defined it all, it was decision intelligence. So they took everyone on a tour, right? Start with the data, they talked about generative AI and what it's good for and what some of its limitations are. That led to agentic AI, right? Into digital twins, and then as Paul, as you said, into quantum AI. And then they brought it all to life through use cases, industry vertical. So it was a nice tour from, you know, where they are now and what they're building, and they brought it to life with real customers, real demos, real use cases. I thought it was really good.
I would agree with that, because in a way the company's almost dismissive of Gen AI.
It really was.
Exactly.
I mean, there was a slide they showed at the beginning that almost said we're in the post-Gen AI era, and they focus more on the weaknesses than the potential. So I thought was good, because we're seeing the real value of AI is now entering more of these agentic and digital twin realm, and generative is, you know, it's one use case, but it's not game changing.
It's building blocks. And actually, one of my predictions for AI this year was that generative AI is going to meet the same fate as the browser wars 25 years ago.
Yeah.
Just like the browser became just a gateway into the world of the internet, and people built around it to get the value out of it. Gen AI is kind of the same thing. It's a gateway into the world of AI. But it doesn't really allow you to make decisions. And that's what I thought was the real focus here was, we're going to build on Gen AI, and you know, agents are going to help you make decisions. Digital twins are going to give you the what if simulations to really figure out what to do. Quantum's going to help solve these highly dimensional, super complex, data intensive workloads, because you need that compute power. And then we're just going to optimize it through our pre-built models and agents and services around your industry, your use case. You know, again, very nice, you know, tour that they brought the customers on that were in the audience.
And they did a good job of integrating the customers into the mix. Yeah. Very often at these keynotes, customers are brought on stage just as kind of to deliver a soundbite. These customers actually had demos of what they're doing and how P&G is tackling the problem of mixing, you know, thousands of different ingredients in a way that doesn't contaminate the other, and it's a problem of exponential complexity, and they showed how they're using quantum AI to tackle that, and that's something that was a really interesting example.
Absolutely, because it's about the safety of the products that we are purchasing and imbibing in some cases. But then she also had a good point about making sure inventory was efficient. some TikTok trend blows up a Pantene product, they've got to make sure that those shampoos are on the shelves when customers want to buy them.
Yeah, I thought they did a nice job too on emphasizing governance and risk management as a foundational message, and human in the loop, and human outside the loop sometimes when it came to the agent. So they had the right mix and the right dimensions on things. And to your point about them mixing in customers and real use cases, it should be said without, even though they weren't on stage, but they're not going alone, right? They have sponsors like Microsoft, AWS, Deloitte, HPE, just to name a few, Red Hat. So they're doing it in partnership with others, which I think even further, you know, lowers the risk of moving down this journey with them.
So Paul, you had mentioned the digital twins, which were a big buzzword on the main stage, and there are a growing number of digital twin solutions out there. What do you think makes the digital twin solutions that SaaS is promoting different and uniquely positioned to tackle some of the problems today?
I think they, because they're statistically grounded, it's not just creating a digital model. They have use cases that are grounded in statistical analysis. The one they showed, one of the things they showed today was what Georgia Pacific is doing with digital twins to maximize manufacturing productivity and to minimize accidents on the floor. And that's a case where digital twins, that's a real useful application. I thought a vivid application of how digital twins can pay off in a manufacturing setting today. We see a lot of use of digital twins in construction, in product design, which are excellent use cases. But I thought how they differentiated today was showing how this technology can be used to improve existing processes.
Exactly.
I think they had a different angle on it than I've been seeing from others. You know, a lot of people talk about digital twins as a process thing, on how digital workers work. This was very focused on simulations, what if scenarios. You know, again, in the realm of decision intelligence. And I thought the other thing that was interesting was that the partnership with Epic Games. So they're bringing in someone who really knows how to do simulations in dynamic, dynamically adaptable things based on what people are doing. So it not only brings an engine to it, but it brings an interface or an experience. So I thought it was a really nice take on digital twins, which of course are going to build on the agents that make the decisions, right?
Right? So digital twins are one manifestation of agents. And agents should be turbocharging the use of digital twins in all types of different contexts, not just in product design, but in modeling processes and improving processes.
Right. Exactly. So how do you, as we discussed, they really talked about times when agents can work on their own and when you really need a human in the loop to either review what the AI is telling you and make sure that in fact you are getting the right information and flag issues that might be arising. How do you think SaaS is working with its customers and working with the organizations to help them understand, okay, here's how we are going to implement this in our business. Here are times when we need a human in the loop, and here are times when we can have the agent working on its own.
I can jump in on that one. It brings me back to the governance and risk management angle that they really emphasized in the keynote. Because, you know, in the end, agents are only going to be as good as people trust them. If they're supposed to be digital coworkers and you're going to be partnering to make decisions, and in some cases, if human workers aren't feasible or warranted, go off and make decisions and take actions on their own, people have to trust it. You know, trust is becoming the currency of innovation. No trust, no ROI, so the focus on governance is really key. And they're making sure the agents are trustworthy. And I thought there was a really nice, proof points behind what they're doing in that realm.
I thought the whole keynote was pragmatic, is a term I'd use. On governance, human in the loop. There was an article in New York Times yesterday about how reasoning agents, which are sort of the latest iteration of generative AI, are actually more prone to hallucinations, as much as 70% in some models. That's concerning. You know, this is a problem that we should be making progress on, not backsliding. And I think information like that just raises the concerns about reliability and doubles down on the importance of human in the loop. And I thought they did a good job of emphasizing that humans are not getting out of this process anytime soon.
Particularly at a time where there are a lot of humans, i.e. workers, who are concerned about jobs displacement.
Yeah. Well, look, obviously, like I said before, AI decision intelligence, I think, was the overriding theme here. You know, so it's not just about trust. It does go back to the unicorn sitting on the rainbow in what they said about generative AI, and they're 100% right, because a prediction is not a judgment. You need judgments to make decisions, and LLMs and generative AI are really about predictions, you know.
Right.
That's what they're about, the statistical probabilities, right? They don't have the understanding of what a judgment really is, and I think that's what they were writing about in New York Times, I think you said, right?
In the Times yesterday.
I think they clearly understand that.
I wanted to ask you about quantum AI. I was not even familiar with that term until this morning. They had a powerful example of what P&G used quantum AI for, to solve a problem that had more permutations than there are atoms in the universe. Do you understand, and the CTO said, quote, quantum is right here, right now, which I was unaware of. What do you know about this?
Yeah, it's starting to emerge out there. I mean, I think the big impact is yet to come. Without going too technical, it's a total reset on how a computer's architected and how it works, with some serious physics involved in it. I mean, it really resets everything, and it unleashes a lot of limitations of what we have today. I would just think of it as, if you have highly complex, you know, lots of permutations and combinations involved in a problem, and it's highly dimensional, meaning there's so many variables, right, that are involved, like high dimensional spaces, and you need really intense compute because you're working on massive, like huge amounts of data. That's what it's good for. And what they pointed out, that the traditional approach took six hours to do the work, where, what was it, 3 minutes?
Well, they got down to 2 minutes with pure quantum. But there were reliability problems. So they did a hybrid approach that got it down to 12 minutes, where the data quality was sufficient and the speed was acceptable.
Look, the way I put it all together on their tour was, Gen AI is going to give you the ability to get into AI and to interact with it. Agents are going to help you make decisions. The digital twins are going to help you simulate what-if scenarios, and then quantum's going to deal with your compute resources and your ability to get things quicker at lower cost, right? And you're right, there's some quality issues that they pointed out with quantum, and that's why they went with that hybrid model, where it gets you closer faster, and then you finish it off with the traditional AI.
Yeah.
So again, they brought that all together into one holistic strategy, which was smart. Differentiated, actually, I think.
So both of you are overwhelmingly positive about the keynote, saying that it was pragmatic, practical, helped you understand, a great tour of where we are now and what's to come. Are there any questions remaining? We have a lot of great guests today. We're going to be talking to Jen Chase, the CMO, Amy Stout, who is the quantum computing expert, Amy McClure, product strategy, in addition to many others. What are some burning questions that you have that you'd like SaaS to answer?
I think solving the reliability problem, as Scott noted, governance is a huge issue. It's trust is the major gating factor right now to broader use of AI in enterprises, and a legitimate one. And vendors have got to prove these models can be trusted.
How about you, Scott?
I won't repeat what you just said. I agree with that. I would say two things. One is, I think AI has become the ultimate team sport in technology. It's all about the ecosystem, because these digital workers are going to have, you can't just hire from one place, right?
Right.
It has to work together. So, and I mentioned earlier, and when we were talking here about the partnerships and the sponsorships, I want to hear more about what they're doing with the ecosystem, so it's not a SaaS-only solution. Then the second thing is, I like to dig deeper into the technology behind the decision intelligence, because that is, I think, the next frontier of AI. Over the next 3 to 4 years, you know, like, you know, the New York Times was writing about, right? You've got to be able to make reliable decisions, otherwise no one's going to trust this stuff.
Exactly.
So I want to dig deeper into that.
Exactly, excellent. Well, this is a great conference that so many big names in technology, but also Frank Abagnale, who is the best-selling author and the subject of Catch Me If You Can, Satya Nadella, Brené Brown, of course, Jim Goodnight, who is the founder and CEO of SaaS. Stay with us, this is going to be a really fun show today. I'm excited to be working with both of you. I'm Rebecca Knight for Scott Hebner and Paul Gillin. Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of SaaS Innovate 2025. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in tech news and analysis.